It's outside the sort of natural silhouette of the body, but he's running across there to block the shot. He is sprinting. He's in a runner's motion.
To some extent, he is. And so what we're going to talk about is it justifiable within the context of this play? He's moving. His right arm is up. But as soon as the ball is struck, he starts to rotate and turn his body. If you take a look, his left hand is tight to within his body, what we say within the silhouette, but the right arm is still extended out. So take a look at the right arm. As soon as he begins to turn, his right arm stays a little bit there. And although the hand is out, it's going to be this next angle that's going to indicate and show that is a bit more of the decisive. This angle, right arm, right hand.
Right, proximity, wow. Christina. Look how close they are. Surely proximity is a mitigating factor for Anderson.
It no longer is. Proximity is no longer a mitigating factor. It used to be, but when the current interpretations with handling, proximity has gone away.
I'm sorry.
Now,
ma'am.
It's being starkly started to be applied back in only when you are stepping in for a challenge and it deflects off your body. Proximity is starting to be added in, but proximity has been taken out over the past 3 years.
I think it's brilliant the way you can explain it like that, but for me, for them to be looking for that as an amble is just never, ever going to sit well with me. I'm sorry. That's just like, I don't know why they're going so deep into the science of that. I can't believe proximity and... I hear what you're saying. The law for me is just like, it's gone crazy.
I'm always critical of the defenders who come out right and they come out and defend and they put their hands behind their back. Because you obviously think your balance can't be right. But that's what you feel for defenders now. I agree. I know what's been said. I can't see that as a penalty. I just can't. The defenders. What else should, does every defender have to put their arms behind their back?
Yeah.
Then you're losing
in
that balance
in
case.
Well.
Yeah, but
because
the player then might maybe try and players might dribble at you and you're off balance, but you just feel for defenders now.
Yeah.
That's not the game we grew up loving, these type of decisions. I think if that wasn't given in the penalty, I don't think everyone tonight or tomorrow morning would be going, what a poor decision.
Yeah. It's crazy.
And you're obviously a Premier League manager, and it's slightly awkward because we've got English referees and English VARs and Michael Oliver making this decision. What's your reaction to that being a penalty?
Well, that's the issue. Michael Oliver is not making this decision.
Exactly.
And that's been my issue all
along.
He
went to the screen, but he could have said no penalty.
But he saw the action. He deemed that it wasn't necessary to be a penalty. That's my problem. If I hear one more person saying that they're not re-refereeing a game, I will blow up. Seriously, because that's exactly what they do. Okay, that is not why. I don't think that is why we bought in technology for that decision. That decision to me is quite an easy one. You know, if it, like Roy said, if that wasn't paid, we wouldn't be talking about it tomorrow. And this is not on Michael Oliver. We're not criticising a referee here. We're criticising the technology, which is what I criticise consistently. I fully back the referee in this. If he did pay that, we'd be saying, okay, he saw it that way. But technology is supposed to be definitive.
And I do want to clarify that point with, what Ange just said, is that this is a clinical clip that is put in front of all FIFA officials and those saying, we want this to be handling offense. So Michael Oliver cannot go to that monitor and say, I refuse to take that recommendation, because this has been issued by FIFA as what he needs to take for consistency across the world. So to your point, it needs to go back into IFAB. And the question is, what does football expect?
Yeah.
And that doesn't come down to the referees. We are told how to interpret and apply. It goes back to IFAB. Is saying, what does football expect?
So it's down to FIFA, not the referees, is essentially what
it comes
you're
down
saying.
To IFAB, correct?
Yeah, to
and then
IFAB.
FIFA does the interpretation.
Because I think before VAR was brought in, I don't think there's a single person in world football, whether they played international football, whether they're a top Premier League manager, whether they played in the park like me and 99.99% of the people watching, who would say that's a penalty. Until VAR, would you agree with me? I don't think there's anybody in any level of the game who'd say, oh, that's a penalty. So how come we've got so far away from what professional football people feel, the rest of us who love football and play football feel, and what IFAB feel? Why is there such a big discrepancy?
One thing I need to clarify, too, is IFAB is not composed of just referees, okay? I've tried to go on IFAB, but I'm American, so I understand I can't. But IFAB is by the United Kingdom. Those are individuals who sit on it, and it includes those different representatives that are leaders of clubs, managers, some FIFA representation. Those are the individuals who have taken and gone through analysis and have talked to high-level football experts, both players as well as managers, and have said, this is where we want this game to be. However, I do note and say that whenever there are big plays that impact a European tournament, law does start to change and interpretation starts to change. So I actually do think that the voices here matter in changing what interpretation.
Because Ange is absolutely right, and he's the Premier League manager. They are re-refereeing microscopic moments, whatever they say. That and there is exhibit one.
Yeah, and Michael Oliver has made all the key match incidents correct pursuant to the interpretations, applications, and guidance.